The Kurds were crucial U.S. allies in the fight against ISIS. CNN's Ben Wiedemann was there when ISIS lost its final piece of territory in eastern Syria. Could the caliphate now rise again?
It was supposed to be the final battle to crush the so-called caliphate of the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria. Reduced to the remote town of Baruz on the banks of the Euphrates River. By night and by day, the U.S.-backed Syrian Democratic Forces, supported by coalition airstrikes, artillery, and mortar fire, pummeled the town for almost 2 months. Thousands of ISIS fighters surrendered as their wives and children fled the town. Yet few of them conceded this was the end of ISIS leader Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi's mad experiment. Omar, a Palestinian refugee who grew up in Syria, told me, maybe the Americans rule the world today, but God Almighty promised the Muslims that in the end, the world will be ruled by Islam. God is testing us, this wife of an ISIS fighter said. The unworthy will leave and the righteous will remain. The fighters and their families ended up in SDF-run prisons and camps. Many came from Europe. The home countries of the foreign fighters refused to take them back. The camps have become microcosms of the caliphate, where women enforce the draconian laws by which ISIS lived and punish those who step out of line. Last month, al-Baghdadi called upon his supporters to breach the walls of the prisons and the camps. And just days after the Turkish invasion began, that has come to pass. Hundreds of ISIS fighters and their families have escaped. As the SDF shifts some of the men and women away from guarding the camps and toward the front lines. The U.S. and its Western allies are now pulling out of northern Syria. As Turkish forces, their Syrian militias, and now the Syrian army rush in, the Americans rush out.
What we're facing is U.S. forces in a trapped between a Syrian-Russian army moving north to take on the Turkish army that is moving south. It puts us in a terrible position, and the protection and safety of our service members comes first to me. I've talked to the president, and he is concerned, and so last night he directed that we begin a deliberate withdrawal of U.S. forces from the northern part of Syria.
The victory over ISIS was a mirage. The effort to crush it has come to naught. The U.S. leaves chaos in its wake. Its so-called deliberate withdrawal seems to be little more than betrayal and retreat. Ben Wiedemann, CNN, Beirut.
For more, David Sanger joins me from Washington. He's a CNN political and national security analyst, as well as a national security correspondent for the New York Times. David, so often we pontificate on TV about the potential ramifications of a decision, you know, months, maybe years down the line. Here, we are seeing those ramifications within days, perhaps hours. It's quite extraordinary.
It is, Nick. And I think the reason for that is that we are seeing events play out on the ground that are speeding up the worst warnings that President Trump has been given really for months now, certainly back in December when he wanted to pull all American troops out of Syria and was told of the consequences. And you'll remember that's when General Jim Mattis, the Secretary of Defense, resigned in protest. So what we're seeing happen now is that in one fell swoop, the president agreed to an action by President Erdogan that ended up empowering the Russians, empowering ISIS, empowering the Iranians, empowering Bashar Assad, and basically selling out the Kurds who had been the American allies.
And I mean, the president has said, and I quote him, that he has great and unmatched wisdom in this area. Is that kind of perhaps misplaced confidence a problem here? Is that what's causing this? Or is there a naivety on behalf of the president? Or is there something more nefarious that is driving his policy here?
You know, I think that'll be debated by historians, by conspiracy theorists for a long time. A few things are clear. He came into office with a very clear view and maybe a mandate from his base to reduce American commitments abroad. He sometimes conflates what he calls endless wars with persistent troop presence, like what you see along the Syrian border, like what you see in Germany, like what you see in Japan and South Korea, where an American force is there as a deterrent, but really isn't taking any casualties and frequently isn't spending all that much money. Certainly, this operation in Syria was a very small one. Thirdly, I think the president has often said that he trusts his own gut. He obviously is not somebody who sits around and spends the evening reading intelligence reports or summaries of policy papers. He very much learned to trust his instincts in the real estate world. And I think it's just another example of why, when you hear sometimes that we need to apply more of the lessons of business to government, it doesn't always work.
But I mean, now what we're seeing are the Kurds making a deal with Damascus. I mean, this has changed the whole picture there on the ground. I mean, what is going to happen in the next month, too, as a result of this?
Well, you know, 2 weeks ago, we couldn't have anticipated this would happen. Back last summer, Jim Jeffrey, the U.S. Special Envoy for Syria and a previous ambassador to Turkey and Iraq, very experienced diplomat, told people at the Aspen Security Forum out in Colorado that the United States presence along that border would be indefinite. Well, clearly he was wrong. So we couldn't predict that this was going to happen. A few things do seem clear. The president on Monday decided to announce some modest sanctions against Turkey and against individual Turks, not against President Erdogan, interestingly enough. I doubt these will be enough to get them to reverse course and pull back to their borders. It's just an effort to see if they can get a ceasefire. I suspect that'll be difficult. I think the second thing you'll see is more empowerment of the Russians, because they're in pretty good shape right now, and their forces are looking pretty good. So Putin's bet during the Obama administration that if he moved into Syria, he wouldn't be pushed back out, that's paying off.
And David, finally, just sort of taking this bigger, I mean, the U.S. is, for good or evil, the kind of world's policeman in a sense. I mean, now, why would any government, why would any faction, why would anybody like the Kurds ever trust this administration again?
They wouldn't. And I think the bigger and more interesting question, Nick, is will they trust the United States again? I mean, the president isn't the first one among in the U.S. to at some point or another give up on an ally, and certainly not the first time the Kurds have been betrayed. That happened, of course, back in the 80s as well. So I think people would be increasingly cautious. And I think you're getting at the central question, which is, at some point, the Trump presidency will end. We don't know whether that's in 2021 or that's in 2025. But at some point, it will. And then the question is it possible to move to rebuild old alliances? Or is this one of those cases where you can sort of never go home again, that the world will have changed in some fundamental ways while President Trump was president, and we're just going to have to adjust? And maybe in a world where China is rising so quickly, adjust to being number two.
David Sanger joining us from Washington. Thank you very much.